quem diz eu era o meu oi. De quem diz eu oi oi. De quem diz eu era o meu oi. De quem diz eu era o meu oi.
Do you think there's still a good answer or will it disappoint you?
All right, so ask your question again.
Okay, so I have this gentleman who is a graduate of Harvard. He's got all these, he's does Zimbabwe-focused research for Columbia Institute, for African Studies, Stanford University, all these, he's got a huge, huge resume. Seems like a very woke person, knows a lot about the African American community, very big advocate. And it seems odd that you then go to his Twitter, and it has things like, Trump is right, America's media is a joke, like, it's got things like Obama was the worst thing that he said. Never has a president promised so much and delivered so little as that of Barack Obama. Like he, like to have such polar views on things that seem pretty connected. I'm wondering if that happens often. Like if you've seen that a lot. If that's just a common thing. If that's common at all, it seems like it wouldn't be.
Yes. It's common. It has actually happened all through Black history. So, for example, Du Bois and Garvey, historically, right? So when we're talking about Du Bois and Garvey, they both had, you know, Du Bois does the NAACP, National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, by which he means, at the time, people of color worldwide, right? So an international framework, not just America, international, right? Garvey, universal Negro Improvement Association, by which he means universal, everybody, planet-wide. You know, so they're both Pan-African, but they both have violent disagreements. Mm-hmm. All right? So, for example, you know, just because, so engaging your critical thinking caps. All right? So, when I said, for example, I don't like Farrakhan because I'm down with Malcolm's family who think Farrakhan was in on the killing of Malcolm, being an inside job. But they kind of, you know, forgave him because he could have, you know, been very nasty to one of their family members that was mentally ill, decided to adopt a whole thing of forgiveness. I didn't like him because of Malcolm, even though I do recognize some of the truths he says. And then I also said that bit about, okay, if a Black conservative Republican says that the Nation of Islam is most effective, even more effective than 12-step groups in getting Black people off of drugs and out of gangs, I gotta listen to that. Right? Even though I might not agree with him, but I, you know, respect Peter Bell because that's who said that. And okay, I'll give anybody that's in the struggle. Now, the person that you talked about, where you have these varying things between what his published work is and then his Twitter feed.
Yeah.
Yeah, there are these weird contradictions that people have displayed, and they've always displayed, and you basically kind of, the logic is called, the African logic is diunital, or the theory of complementary opposites. All right, and so in that complementary opposites, so one of the phrases that typifies it is love your enemies, which actually doesn't make sense in dichotomous logic and for Europeans. You're supposed to hate your enemies. Mm-hmm. But in Aramaic, it's actually instructions on how to do it. And basically what the love that they're talking about is a third type of love other than what is referred to in English, which came from the Greek. So there's agape, you know, brotherly love, and eros, which is erotic love. That's the only type of love they talk about in Christianity from the Western point of view. But in Aramaic, which is instructions on how to do it, aheb means a universal transpersonal force that brings opposites together in secret to create new life. Okay, so to love your enemy, it's like self-knowledge. In order to love your enemy, you have to know yourself and then know your enemy in the sense of, well, another diunital logic, the enemy of my enemy is my friend. So in order to actualize that, you actually have to know, okay, why is the enemy of my enemy my friend? My enemy's got enemies. So what is the history behind that? Why are those people, why can I use the enemy's enemy as an ally, potentially? Well, I have to know who they are and why they are, all right? A person like that, so I'll use the example of, there's a conservative black linguist named McWhorter. Now, I intellectually understand why he's saying what he's saying, even though I don't like the conservativeness, because you might have gathered I'm not conservative. Oh, okay, I'm a conservative radical. Which means radical social justice change as fast as possible without using military force. That's the conservative part. Everything else, radical in the sense of like the radical Republicans. Okay. And white supremacy, give equal justice to everybody, every human being, no matter what. Obama's, what I might agree with his whole thing about Obama, somewhat, it's not because of Obama's fault. He got resisted, even though, even for example, the whole Obamacare, which is actually a white idea, from Mitt Romney, conservative Republican. You know, if you really think about what Obamacare should have been, every American citizen has free health care, the same health care that Congress gets for free. Every American. So whether or not you're employed or not, no pre-existing conditions, none of that. That's what the idea behind Obamacare was. That's not what we got because of Republican pushback. So to call it socialism, no, it's not socialism. You call yourself Christians. How much did Jesus charge for health care?
Yeah, for me, it doesn't seem like a ridiculous idea to say by executive order, there's going to be a new tax. Everybody's going to pay it. Everybody has health care now.
Yeah. Right.
Everybody's paying this tax. I mean, right. If you work, there's a tax. It's not going to be that much if we all pay it. Now everybody's covered.
Right.
Done.
You could do that. It's very simple. And it's a very simple principle about, okay, national security should be linked to the health of the people.
Yeah.
Everybody fed, everybody housed. I mean, because indigenously, before America, Europeans got here, we didn't have poor people. We didn't have homeless people. It dishonored the nation to have poor people and homeless people. Yeah. That was a value in all of Turtle Island. So what changed? So again, this whole idea behind, when you have conflicting ideas, you have to use your critical thinking and say, okay, where is he accurate? Where is he like off the wall? And when you look at, okay, because I'm a mental health professional, and I'm into facts and science and consensus reality, which means most people agree that this is real. Now, many times, and certainly in America, most people, when it definitely was, you know, we wasn't even institutional racism, it was like widespread, like the time period we're looking at, violence against entire communities of people and no repercussions. That was, there's no other word for saying it, insane. But it was normal. right? So then when the consensus was racism, no, I'm not going to agree with that. There's going to be pockets of sanity. And not every white person was down with that, but they also didn't say anything. They also didn't stop it. Mm-hmm. You know, if I may, you know, be so bold, the difference between a liberal and conservative at a lynching is this. The conservative thinks you had it coming and is clapping. The liberal wrings their hands. Oh, sorry, but they don't stop them.
Yeah.
A radical acts, even using deadly force if necessary against the lynchers.
That's something about it.
Okay? So that's what, you know, when conservatives call me a liberal, it's like, no, not. Okay? Call me an uppity nigger. That's actually more accurate. Oh, you use the N-word. A black person using the N-word. No, I'm just, you know, you have this phrase, call a spade a spade. Look, I'm uppity. I at least think I'm equal and demonstrably am superior in terms of demonstrating my intellect, my compassion, my activism over you. So, you know, I understand why you may be conservative, but... Yeah. So I want to move on. Hope that got...
Yeah.
Good question. Because we come upon it a lot. So, you know, basically people will have different tactics and they'll agree. So if there's any questions about the material. So here's one of the things that I do because I've gotten a couple of pieces of feedback from people who felt they didn't do so well in the quiz and all that kind of stuff. The quiz will come around again as a midterm. But would you like a study guide for the midterm and other tests, and which will often consist of the preferred answer? Okay. Quiz seems pretty easy. All right. Too easy? Well, I could make it harder.
I didn't know we had
no, just leave it right where it's at. It's perfectly fine.
Yeah, on Moodle.
Just the one.
Yeah.
We only had one, right?
Just the one. There's another one today.
Which it was just posted.
Yeah, just got posted today.
Yeah. Scared me because it said.
Can I still go back in and do the quiz? I don't even know we
had a quiz. So email me. You'll need a password to get in, and I'll do a user override to let you do that.
What is the reading? The quiz?
So here's the piece. I was getting that. Thanks for asking the question. Here's the answer. All right. I'm having you read two books by black historical activists. Malefi covers Africa, and the reason there's still a connection between not only Africans and African Americans, more than just the name. We're talking about policy. We're talking about colonialism. So people are resisting, like Africans are definitely resisting, like right after the Berlin Conference, they're resisting and saying, okay, we need to get together and figure out how to do this. They're resisting from jump, but we don't hear about that here. So that's why Malefe Asante's book is really cool, because when you look at, you know, Gandhi's work, because Gandhi started out in South Africa before he went to India, which is why a lot of people like Du Bois are bringing Gandhi to, or trying to bring Gandhi to America. Oh, look, we're not going to fight the Civil War all over again. There's not enough of a population to fight back against the Klan or whatever. We need to do a nonviolent peace. That was a decision. So there's Pan-Africanism, that is all of Africa, and there's pan-globalism, all, you know, both in America and Africa. So I want to capture that thread, and then Robin Kelly's book, To Make Our World Anew, because that's more or less standard knowledge within the intelligentsia of the black community, but it isn't common knowledge in the traditional canon. But I'm going to basically focus in the class referring to some of what's in the book, but also some of the backstory that happens here. Because it's in neither book. Not that I'm saying that there's a deficit in either book. I'm just saying there's more material then I can possibly cover or test you on without making the test inaccessible. And I need for you to understand this stuff is accessible material for you so you can apply it to your situation, whatever that is. Because every year, I always think this class is going to be the last year. Because, you know, they might get hip, especially for what's about to follow.
This next year, you might actually be right.
Yeah, right.
Is there already silencing the, like, national parks?
Yeah. Okay. Which, you know, again, hey, pay attention to the news, read the newspaper, get the daily news, et cetera, et cetera. But understand, you know, you still haven't been, you don't suspend your critical thinking. You know, beware of alternative facts. Yes, that's what they're calling it.
I love that.
Wow. Okay, you are lying straight up, and you're not even bothering to hide it like other politicians before you. Cool. All right. Name four streets named after people of color in Eugene.
MLK Boulevard.
Okay, well, that's a gimme.
That's actually Centennial Boulevard. Into.
Yeah.
Yeah, they just added.
What was it before Centennial?
It's always been Centennial.
Nope, hasn't.
Oh, it was. Okay.
Well, we'll come to that when we come to the name change thing.
In my 40 years, it was, you know, Centennial.
Yes, it was something before Centennial. Okay, so. Okay. MLK Boulevard is a gimme. And usually, MLK Boulevards across the country is in the hood, right? Mm-hmm. But what if there was no hood allowed to form in Eugene? I'll let you marinate on that for a second. So, other people of color. Okay.
I haven't lived here long.
Okay, that's all right. So, why I'm bringing this up is because Eugene, well, and Oregon, so, you know, I lived in a place, L.A., which had an MLK Boulevard, right? An MLK Boulevard, like in Portland or MLK, anywhere else, runs through the hood. But if there was no hood, then where do you put MLK Boulevard? Like you said, Centennial. But Centennial wasn't always named Centennial. But who do you name streets after, and why do you name streets after people? So look at that protocol. If they're not numbered streets, and or if they're not geographical features like Willamette, who do you name streets after?
Presidents.
Presidents, that's good.
Trees.
Trees?
That's geological.
Yes, right, trees. What else?
Portland uses the alphabet.
Yeah, right? A Street, B Street, C
Portland
Street.
It's like Ash.
Numbers,
Portland
Ash,
has, like,
right?
Farms, though, too.
Huh?
And Cesar Chavez.
Cesar Chavez.
Cesar Chavez, right? Okay. So historical American
figures.
Yeah. But that's only relatively recent.
And then Belmont was a local figure, wasn't
right?
it?
Right. Belmont was a local figure in Portland, right?
Hawthorne.
Tree, or also a person.
Burnside.
Yeah, you notice you're using Portland reference, but
yeah,
again,
exactly. I know Portland a lot better than I know Eugene.
Well, sure, and I used to work for the feds in Portland, so yeah, right, I know that,
yeah.
those areas, so. All right, so two more. Actually, more than two more, but Sam Reynolds Street. That's out almost to Bertelson, West 11th and Bertelson.
Oh, yeah, in the middle of nowhere.
Yeah. It was outside of the city limits. When we get to that history, we'll talk
out
about
by
that.
Out by Hynix.
Huh?
Out by Hynix or what?
Not quite Hynix. Still straight out West 11th before you get to Walmart and all that kind of stuff.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So, Sam Reynolds Street. Moon Lee Lane. Moon Lee actually just died about, inside of a year ago. Chinese man that used to work for the U of O, had his ashes scattered right in front of the U of O psych building. That's how much of a Duck fan he was. But he also was connected with university housing. So Moonlee Lane, like about 19th and Agate, if I recall correctly. So MLK, Sam Reynolds, Moonlee Lane, and then also Unthank Street. Now, if you know Portland, there's an Unthank Park. That's his dad. But DeNorville Unthank was a black architect, went to Howard University, went to the U of O, was an architectural student, taught architecture at the U of O, and designed several buildings at the U of O, as well as every U.S. bank building, U.S. embassies, Kennedy Middle School, Thurston High School. Great guy, actually. I knew him before he died. So, Unthank Street. So when we talk about history, so I and my wife, Sherry Turbin, created a project. We had created a history project called I2M Eugene after a Langston Hughes poem. And gonna do that anyway. I thought I removed that formatting, but okay. I too sing America. I am the darker brother. They send me to eat in the kitchen when company comes, but I laugh and eat well and grow strong. Tomorrow, I'll sit at the table when company comes. Nobody will dare say to me, eat in the kitchen then. Besides, they'll see how beautiful I am and be ashamed. I too am America. So I2M Eugene basically takes its title from that Langston Hughes poem. And basically, like that poem, I2M Eugene basically seeks to tell the stories and historical context of people of color in Eugene. And a lot of times you basically use the black part of that to build the basis of this class, because we had seven kids in the Eugene School District, and one of, both our sons got into little conflicts because the older son said that Beethoven was black, because he got that from me, even though I had, and his teacher, like my fifth grade teacher said, Beethoven's not black because he's German, and yeah, right, Schwarzenegger means black and from Africa, so what do you think, you know, anyway. And then the other son, basically only one classroom in his building was going to talk about why we have Martin Luther King's birthday off, why there was a holiday, one classroom in the school. And so we said, what are you doing for Black History Month? Oh, well, nothing. Can you do something? Wait, you're the teacher. What are we paying our taxes for? So Sherry decided, well, that's whack. So she, because we're old school, she goes to the microfilm room in Knight Library and basically goes through every newspaper that ever got published in that place and goes from day one and goes day by day, year by year, yeah, to the present day in microfilm. And then would call me up and say, did you know? Right? I said, no, babe. what? Wait a minute. I mean, because we're both not from here.
Yeah.
So we've never lived in communities that didn't have ethnic neighborhoods for communities of colors. Like, this place is weird. Why is that? And then when you understand the history, oh, that's why that is. How, you know, so that's when we, you know, for all of those people of color, so we're activist historians. And what activist historians means is you don't have political agency unless your history is alive and well and talked about. Right? Columbus discovered America, presidents, you know, centennial, blah, 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 right? But where is Martin Luther King Boulevard and why is it at centennial? Where is Sam Reynolds Street? And you know what? If you've visited my office, you see a street sign that says Sam R. Well, that's the same Sam R. But why did they spell it Sam R. instead of spelling his name out? Mm-hmm. Well, not because he was a 12-stepper, which is the only time that you ever do that. Hey, I'm Sam R. I'm an alcoholic or whatever. No, you don't. That wasn't why. Someone in the sign shop said, we're not going to honor a nigger. And so they didn't spell his name out. And the city let that stand for 24 years. Basically told the family, oh, well, Sam Reynolds is too long. Willa Gillespie?
That's kind of long.
Oh, Sam Reynolds, there's another Reynolds in out by Lorraine. People, emergency services might get confused. Okay, so Reynolds Street, Reynolds Boulevard, Reynolds Avenue, I think, you know, your emergency services are not going to get confused.
S. Reynolds.
Yeah, or whatever. Okay, all your reasons don't make sense, and the real reason is, you know, you let racism in the sign department block you from honoring this guy. So me and Sherry, you know, waged an email battle and said, okay, after you had all this trouble getting Martin Luther King Boulevard, maybe, and you were fighting that, so maybe you should just do change Sam Reynolds and you should waive the fee of $500 to change two signs. Do it for free. Be nice, guys. Just a suggestion. So our intent basically is to create a basis for mutual understanding and continued collaboration. So many of these stories are oral history. And we also started from microfilms of old newspapers, past amateur scholarship, like Ockley Glenn, who was a police lieutenant, who basically did a history of the black community. Past professional scholarship, basically the Negro of Eugene in the 1930s, which was published at the University of Oregon, the Negro in Oregon, the chapter of Klan and Gown, which is where some of the Klan material came from a UofO scholar. Various interviews and what I'll call sleuthing. So it's collaborative historical activism. So for example, a talking stone, which is there are, so can you name the native nation that lived here?
Kalapuya.
And there's three bands of the Kalapuya. So there's Yonkawa Kalapuya, Sanchivan Kalapuya, which is basically here, Chela Mela Kalapuya out by Vanita. So the Kalapuya are all through the Willamette Valley. And there are 144 words and no native speakers, but 144 words left in Yonkawa Kalapuya. And the Talking Stones Project is basically naming 15 of those words, 15 or 16 of those words. We were involved with that project. Wiley Griffin Memorial Stone, MLK Boulevard, Sam Reynolds Street, BSU's Tent City Reenactment. We've contributed to LCC's Rites of Passage and this class, LCC's Black Studies Union Advising and other things like that. So this is what the city's official word, basically, the struggles of non-white groups in early Eugene, though often understated, is an important part of the community's history. Cultural groups that resided or in or near Eugene City during the initial period of growth and development included Native Americans, African Americans, Chinese, and Japanese. There is little information regarding the occupations or residency of these groups in Eugene specifically, but it seems that tolerance for non-white population was low. Now, while they make that statement, they make no efforts to talk about or expand on or research the history. Until we asked for $5,000 of seed money around year 2000. So this was basically in the mid-90s. So I2M Eugene basically is the original purpose was to provide a school-based curriculum K-12 as Oregon history was being taught by a video game, Oregon Trail. And if your pioneer or whatever died of dysentery in Missouri, that was it. And that was the limit. I mean, literally, I'm not making that up. That was... wait, you're using a video game to talk about your history? I mean, like in California, we learned about Junipero Serra and all the missions, you know, in Santa Barbara and San Diego and San Francisco. Why aren't you guys doing that?
This was, video game was just turned into a board game recently.
Yeah, I bet. All right, so many Eugene institutions... Yeah, when I copy this... So originally, part of this presentation was going to go to eWeb to run in their lobby during Black History Month. And when it came to the Klan section, because you can't really talk about Black history without talking about the Ku Klux Klan, at least that's what I thought, they suppressed it. So what I'm going to show you was part of, you know, which actually we've been showing for 20 years since, you know, Sherry discovered this. Wait, did you know the Ku Klux Klan was here? And that there was like two lists of names and, yeah, yes.
Wasn't there codes with the banks? The banks wouldn't loan money to,
Right.
Like all through the whole state, or was it just Portland?
No, it was through the whole state, particularly in Eugene, but yeah, through the whole state.
I know that the Klan had a rally in Portland, like, I want to say a year and a half to 2 years ago. And everybody that I know, their reaction was, what? I didn't know the Klan was in Oregon.
Yeah. Right. Right.
You're like, dang, you don't know anything about Oregon.
Well, yeah. I mean, so when I was basically talking about, okay, so there are those... who for a very long time, to the present day, basically denied there was a KKK presence in the state and the city, and that influenced history, politics, and the conditions here. The official story is that the Klan died in 1925. Now, they weren't talking about the Klan before we started talking about it 20 years ago. Like, the UFO basically did not even acknowledge that they had a Klan presence until mid this year. Not 17, but 16. Didn't acknowledge it at all.
Are they saying the Klan died in Oregon in 1925?
They're saying the Klan died in Eugene in 1925 and that it was kind of a fad. Yeah, well, the Klan was here, but it, you know, officially died in 1925. And I'm just here to tell you that's a lie.
Everybody has their radicals.
Yeah.
There's that guy that lives in Springfield.
Yeah. That's a lie. Okay? And it's a provable lie. And I'll show you why it's a lie. So, So there are those Eugenians who basically say that Frederick Dunn, for example, was duped and he was tricked into being in the Klan.
Oh, yeah.
So while it is true there were very few black people in the 1910s, 1920s, 1930s, say less than 100, for the Klan to act against those folks, I mean, so yeah, it was largely Catholics they were acting against because the Catholics were more numerous and more influential than the black people. But in the 40s and 50s and beyond, they became more and more active and more acting against the black community like Klans did in the South. So it's very accurate to basically say Oregon is a southern state in the Northwest. Now I took this picture, and it's the Stewart Pond is basically the has a bird hide, and it's just west of Fred Meyer, and this is taken in the summer of 2004. So I don't know who does tagging, but and the Klan doesn't traditionally do tagging, but why would somebody
Someone
put that?
Thought it was appropriate.
Somebody thought it was appropriate in the 21st century. So part of the historical evidence, such as David Horowitz's book, Eckhart Tolle's book, basically does talk about the Klan historically in the 20s. But while a toy gun is not a real gun, it can be acted upon and reacted to as if it was a real gun, according to police, as necessary. So what Eckhart Tolle, who is a Klan scholar, he studies far-right groups as an academic pursuit. He's not far-right. He's actually pretty cool. Old man lives in Hood River. So he did a lot of the historical work, got his doctorate on studying the Klan at the U of O, and his master's thesis. So had a lot of material, and he was using a slideshow. So I went to his house in Hood River and digitized his slides because he had a lot of really cool pictures. Now,
like a literal like slide.
Yeah, slide like show. In a carousel.
Not like a PowerPoint slideshow.
No. People that age, and I include myself, but people that age were not in the digital world. Okay, they use actual slides, which is actual photographs, and he had actual slides. So I said, yo, Ecker, listen, I'll come up and, he and his wife were very gracious, and I basically took my computer and a scanner and basically one by one just digitized those slides and made a PowerPoint presentation for him so he could basically, let's get it to the 20th
on a wider range too.
Yeah, I mean, and yeah, I have like 100 slides, which I'm not going to show you, but I'm just going
to. Will you share them to Moodle? Do you have that?
I could.
Could you, I don't know how much work it would be for you, but if you emailed that to the ATC, I could get that done
Okay.
On time.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool. Sure. Love to.
Yeah.
Because again, I mean, as a historical piece, it's really fascinating. I mean, because you're wondering, why are these folks doing what they're doing? What is their worldview? I mean.
Yeah, I went for a couple, like, doing their yard. They're like, they're like in their, almost their 80s. And the woman's Puerto Rican, but they moved up here from Southern California. And the guy's like, man, he's like, I'm white. He's like, but once they found out my wife was Puerto Rican, he's like, we were both hated equally. He's like, in the first, for the last, it's like up to like the 90s, like my being in this neighborhood, he's like, she was the only person of color in the neighborhood. And she's like, and people would like, she couldn't walk down the street because they would like say hateful remarks to her. And I had no idea, I was like, I've lived in Eugene all my life. And not until I got to college that I find out that it was like racist.
Yeah. I didn't show you this the other day, but I could have, but I just wanted to, this is the same Thurston that Thurston High School was named after. Mm-hmm. It is a question of life or death to us in Oregon. The Negroes associate with the Indians and intermarry, and if their free ingress is encouraged or allowed, there would be a relationship spring up between them and the different tribes, and a mixed race would ensue, inimical to the whites. So, yeah, and the Indians being led on by the Negro, who is better acquainted with the customs, language, and manners of the whites, that the Indian, these savages, would then become much more formidable than they otherwise would, and long bloody wars would be the fruits of the commingling of the races. It is this principle, the principle of self-preservation, that justified the actions of the Oregon legislature. So he's basically saying the reason we're banning black American citizens from Oregon is because they mix with Indians. Now, okay, there's a historical precedent like Jamaica, like Mexico, like other places like that. So Senator Thurston basically is advancing the idea that that's stated in the United States, the states in the United States be admitted to the Union on the principle of excluding citizens of color.
I'm surprised that they haven't changed the name of Thurston High School.
Yeah, I went to the high school.
Yeah.
And I had no idea. Where does the
name
come from?
Right. Okay.
10 years later.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, well, you know, you could see what kind of problems we had with Deddy Hall and Dunn Hall.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Yeah, I like how Thurston High School, they had a multicultural week.
Yeah.
And I got Mexican, and like teaching the school about Mexican culture was having a salsa making competition on Friday. The last
salsa competition.
It's like, how does that help people learn about where my pants came from? Like, okay.
Right.
It's like, oh, Martin Luther King on Monday, and we'll just talk about him and nothing else.
Why don't you know Mexicans love salsa?
No, yeah, but
what else is there to know?
Yeah, let's see, tacos, chicken wings, watermelon, fried chicken. Sure, yeah. I mean, yeah, so, it's... So, here's a parade in 1924, basically. Two local bands, public initiation into the Klan at the fairgrounds, speaker. Yeah, so fireworks on the Butte. And then this is the rally at the fairgrounds. Join the KKK. 1924 rally at Lane County Fairgrounds. Yeah. So, like, I will be showing you the Klan list because no Eugene media outlet has published the Klan list in 90 years. So they,
is it up to date?
No.
Damn.
The Klan is a secret organization, secret fraternal organization. So, part of, you know, this, like this particular thing with a drop of red blood, this is the red-blooded American. The idea of red-blooded American is a phrase from the Klan.
Don't we all bleed red blood?
We all do bleed red blood, but some people are racially pure. So, for example, in this picture, you know, Eckhart broke it down. He said, okay, you notice not everybody's wearing a white robe. Okay, the loyal order of the red robe is people who are not white Anglo-Saxon Protestant, but possibly mixed race like Italian, Swedes, Russians, etc. So people who are non-WASPs, but still can join the Klan.
They just don't get a hood and a robe.
Well, they get a different color robe because the white robe is the white, you know, white purity.
Gotcha.
Okay?
Anglo-Saxon, that's the British, right?
Yeah, Anglo-Saxon, so yeah, the British and, you know, the Vikings and Protestant, because Catholics
Irish.
Are ruled by, you know, Rome, which, you know, race mixes, blah, 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 blah.
That's in Italy, so why would Italian?
Yeah, yeah, okay, well, I mean, again, this is their worldview, right? So, yeah, so red-blooded American.
I don't think that their thought process is like...
Clearly, they did not think this
there.
All the way out.
Yeah. so this is Polk's Guide, which is like the phone book. Remember those?
Yeah.
The phone book, okay, from 1925. And this particular page has the Klan's phone number, which is a three-digit number. Ku Klux Klan, number 3, Realm of Oregon. M. Beckwith, M. J. Thompson, Secretary, Beckwith Building, telephone 277, which means, you know, if you understand that telephones could have three-digit phone numbers, because that's how many phones there were, less than 1,000.
Oh, damn. That's crazy.
Right? 1925.
Yeah. Well, the Klan
had that's what they still had.
But the Klan had one, and they had an office. In the Beckwith Building, which I told you, you know, the Hi-Fi Music Hall now.
Does it say Delta Gamma?
The Beckwith Building is now the Hi-Fi Music Hall.
Yeah.
What was that again?
There's a student who was in Delta Gamma.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that's looking towards the...
that's looking north, south on Willamette.
Looking away from
the Butte.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, looking away from the Holt Center. The Holt Center is the Heilig Theater, which also featured in the Japanese relocation, because that's where they were rounded up and took,
yeah,
in this particular theater. That's why there is a Japanese relocation memorial at the Holt Center.
Oh, wow. I didn't know.
Okay, right? So, I mean, again, yeah. There are all these, you know, historical monuments happening within a particular time period that we were either friends with or helped facilitate. The Japanese community basically had, you know, kind of facilitated their own, because some of the survivors still were alive that had gotten loaded up onto cattle cars and stuff like that at the train station, which is right there.
Wow.
Right? So, yeah.
Sent down to Klamath Falls.
Or, yeah, Klamath Falls or other places too.
When they were putting in German camps?
Yes. So, Frederick Dunn, the UFO did not have a separate student Clavern, but it did have Exalted Cyclops Dunn, football coach C.A. Shy Huntington, a few faculty members, graduate manager Jack Benefiel, secretary, several different alumni, Klan members, with businesses that catered to students, half a dozen students, perhaps, including this guy named Maurice Wilcox, who wrote a paper strongly supporting the Klan. So, by and large, the UFO students were actually against the Klan, and what's the paper there? The Eugene Emerald basically published a bunch of editorials basically denouncing the Klan. But in Corvallis, there was a student Clavering.
No surprise.
At OSU. Yeah, no surprise there, right? So the Morning Register, so there were two papers, the Morning Register, which is the Republican paper, anti-slavery, and the Democratic paper, the Daily Guard. Basically, Morning Register reports Klan organizing in Eugene. 80 men have joined in August 7, 1921. Note the Register notes 80 men have joined, but offers no list. Nearly 140 people, so nearly 140 people, Klansmen, of Klan number 3, identifiable in 1922, 60% or more engaged in middle class occupations, semi-skilled or skilled labor, 80% were married, the majority living in exclusive or more stable neighborhoods, which is basically Reed Rich. Exalted Cyclops Dunn, head of the Latin department. Cyclops basically is the head of a city or town, like I explained the other day. Grand Dragons Control the State, Klan's Agenda, 100% Americanism. Largely, they were anti-Catholic because there were few blacks. So, for example, removal of Catholics from public offices and public schools. So before Centennial was named Centennial in 1959, it was referred to as Old Patterson Road. Now, there are two Klansmen, Brigham and Patterson, who got two Catholic teachers fired from the Eugene School District who were Klansmen. I mean, Brigham and Patterson were Klansmen, and they got two Catholic teachers fired from the Eugene schools, and they're on the list. So one of, in my testimony to the city of Eugene, to basically, okay, let's rename Centennial Martin Luther King, and they were using a historical argument, and I said, okay, well, here's a map that identifies Centennial as Old Patterson Road. So is that the Patterson that was a Klansman that got two Catholic teachers fired? You can't tell me that they're not because there's no historical record. So I'm thinking that it might be okay to let go of the Centennial and do MLK. Just saying. Locally, they opposed Mercy Hospital, which became Sacred Heart, and the Newman Center at the University of Oregon.
Still a Catholic hospital.
Still a Catholic hospital, right?
Newman Center still there.
We have duplication. So, Klan members included county commissioner, two city officials, including Alta King, an attorney, Eugene City Recorder, local National Guard commander, rector of the Episcopal Church, a newspaper publisher, a dentist, a surgeon, new officers elected by the Chamber of Commerce, the Elks Club, Ben Doris of Doris Ranch, Clyde Fisk, Major William C. White, American Legion, Joseph Turnbull of Turnbull Shelton Printing, which published the Register Guard. Shelton Turnbull is still a business, but it's owned by a Jewish man now. They just retained the name because it had name familiarity, but he thinks it's amusing that these were once Klansmen, that, and he was aware of that history. So to put some of those names in perspective, Frederick Dunn was also Dunn's School, which was the 4G Multicultural Library. Ben Doris of Doris Ranch. Joseph Shelton was the publisher of the Eugene Daily Guard, the Democratic pro-slavery newspaper. And Turnbull was his business partner in terms of printing. Turnbull was the Elks Club secretary. Historically, the Elks Club and the Klan in Eugene have been very much linked together historically. Shelton Turnbull Printing, as I talked about before. Walter Pierce was a Democratic governor endorsed by the Klan. Casper K. Kubley, who taught at the University of Oregon, was mentioned in a book called The Story of Eugene, was given an honorary membership in the Klan because of his initials.
Was he even white?
Yeah, he was white.
Doesn't sound white.
In fact, in that, you'll have to go back when I post this to Moodle, but his daughter went to the U of O, Catherine Kubley. He definitely had a thing for K's. Klan started initially with two riders galloping down Willamette Street in 1921-22. To a parade down Willamette Street, and initially at the initiations at the fairgrounds in 1924, with cross burnings both at the fairgrounds and also at the top of the Butte.
That was after Birth of a Nation already came out?
Yeah.
Didn't they keep a cross that was just lit up, it wasn't burning?
Ah, okay. You ask that question, I have to give you the answer to. So, the Register Guard. Actually, there had been several amateur historians, and one of them was the history of the cross on Eugene. So, clan crosses were burnt both on Skinner's Butte and on what was called Emerald Hill, or also called Kelly Butte, which is where the Springfield Water Tower is. Okay, so if you go to the top of those places, okay, you have line of sight.
The train tracks, right?
Right, okay, so here's what the Register Guard said. Because remember, the Register Guard was owned by a Klansman until it was sold to the current Baker family. Now, I've asked the question, all right, who does a Klansman employ for his newspaper, and when it was sold to the Bakers, did they fire the Klansman's employees or continue to hire them? Now, we can tell from the way they report news, because the black community, the Klan continued burning crosses up there, and it ceased to be reported as news by the guard. But black people said, yeah, we're working for the railroad, and there was the Ferry Street community, and the crosses got burned there every Friday night to intimidate the Ferry Street community, which basically was in present-day Alden Baker Park. In the 40s or 50s, and the Register Guard basically said, a series of wooden crosses existed at that spot until somebody overnight erected a concrete and neon cross without a permit, and the city just let it stay there. So when we talk about, when we think about, okay, well, who erected that cross, that particular businessman, one of your predecessors as far as students worked for that guy who basically made racial slurs in front of his black secretary, so we kind of get an idea of his orientation pretty easily. So if you're in Oregon and Oregonians understand rain and wood, so why would there be a series of wooden crosses? Wouldn't you varnish them? Wouldn't you lacquer them to basically last the rain? Well, they were burnt, but that's not what the Register Guard would say. It says a series of wooden crosses. Why a series?
Because they had to put up a new one after they burned them.
Yeah, did it get eaten by termite? Yeah, right. It just, yeah, a series of wooden crosses. So that's a great code.
What it makes it think is that there's like a row. Like there's a series of them all together.
Yeah. So it, yeah, it got removed and moved to, I think, Eugene Christian College, where it's still, you know, up Bailey Hill or whatever. The black community basically said, yeah, once we got moved out to West 11th, people burned crosses in front of St. Mark's Church every Friday, just like they had been burning crosses every Friday on the Butte. But that, again, ceased to be reported as news into the 50s and 60s.
I also heard that, like, the Carmelite Convent used to be across the street from St. Mary's, and they would, like, is that there too?
Quite possibly. So, there were 400 members in attendance at the rally at the fairgrounds.
Going up by five, like northbound, isn't there a, you know, like a lighted cross too up on the top of a hill somewhere?
Yes.
It's a little
yes.
South, right?
Yes. That is an interesting placement for that
so
particular.
Like Harrisburg up by
yeah.
five. Yeah, so now it just got me like thinking because I'm like, okay.
Yeah. There are numerous barns, you know, basically part of Sherry and I's research, basically there were painted on barns A-Y-A-K. That's a code question, are you a Klansman? and then "A Klansman I Am" on the side of Barnes on the roof. There was one also going to Portland that had that for a while until it was painted over in about the 90s. So, I mean, again, this, the whole Klan piece. So, for example, the reporter Jeff Wright, who was basically talking about history, Ku Klux Klan had influential presence in Eugene, and basically has a picture of Shai Huntington as the football coach, etc. there. So I gave him access to the list, but they didn't publish it. And I said, look, the list is 90 years old. There's no big, it's 90 years old, okay? You may have some names that are still
city names.
Still city names, city streets. There are at least five or six people working at Lane that, you know, had names that appeared on the Klan list. Okay, so maybe they're not Klansmen now. Maybe it's somebody else's name. I mean, for example, the current police chief, okay, who's Catholic, I believe. So,
Kearns,
yeah, Kearns. There's a Kearns on the Klan list, but you know he's Catholic. So, okay,
probably
somebody on another Kearns, right? And you know, but again, this is still part of the community's history that, you know, people need to understand and come to grips with. So if we look at then you know, the second decree, application for admission to the second degree, this is not a Eugene Klan, because the Klan is a secret organization. So where was Frederick Dunn's Klan robe? Where was Frederick Dunn's Klan ID? That should be in special collections at the U of O, right? Think about that, but it wasn't. In fact, no reference to Frederick Dunn as a Klan member existed at the U of O library.
Makes the university look bad.
But they're willing to say that there was a Klan in Tillamook, but not here. Mm-hmm. Huh. Well, wait, you gave a master's degree and a doctorate degree to a researcher that did his research at the U of O that exposed the Klan. Why not just say that it happened there? Why not? Just historically. So, we basically looked at, yeah, and there's other communities like Klan Parade in Albany around the same time. So let me skip to, yeah, the Toledo incident was basically a incident in which they moved a number of Japanese people who were working in a sawmill out of Toledo. Okay, so here's the Klan list.
So does that move anything like what happened in Snake River in Idaho?
Wasn't that a massacre?
Yeah, but it happened around the same time as the founding of Oregon, so I thought it would be substantial considering we're talking about Oregon's history as it pertains to racism and racial issues that are happening in the nation as a whole. So I just thought that might come up in the subject matter.
Yeah, the Snake River was a massacre of Chinese mine workers, I think.
But it also showed that the prominence of the marginalized communities were really prevalent. The fact that those Chinese miners had owned property, stakes, and actually were the reasons that Idaho was actually a book city.
Yeah, the Toledo incident was different in that it simply moved, relocated, however you want to phrase it, Japanese workers without killing them.
Are there memorials along the gorge for that exact...
Yeah, the Snake River thing, yeah. Right. So there were two lists. So why I'm referring to the third list, basically when I published the list through this class of 140, 150 people, here's where the sources of the list came from. So Klansmen beat up an LAPD officer. So the LA police, you know, the LAPD, well, police departments don't take kindly to their officers getting beat up by anybody. So the police raided a Klan, we'll call it a safe house, and they got the organizing list for 5 states, including Oregon. Okay, so Eckhart Tolle basically got that, and I got that from the LA DA's office. And then there was a list published by the Salem Capital Journal, Harry Crane. And then there was another list where 4 girls were playing on Emerald Hill in Springfield, and they saw a line of cars traveling up the hill, so they hid in the bushes and witnessed a cross burning.
What was the significance of these lists, and how were they attained?
I'm telling you. So the girls hid in the bushes. They watched a guy with a, you know, they had a cross burning, people writing down their names, and he dropped the list. And then they went away. And the girls hiding in the bushes came out, got the list, and turned them into their parents, who obviously weren't Klan friendly, because then their parents turned the list over to the Salem Capital Journal, because no Eugene paper would have published the list, because the Eugene papers were under the control of the Klan at the time. Right? So 3 lists. 2 lists, basically, one published, another list found by the girls on top of Emerald Hill, and a 3rd list, basically, from the LADA's office. So we put those lists together, and we got basically 140 people. So Exalted Cyclops Dunn, Benjamin Doris, Clyde Fisk, and I actually had a student, and I guess I could put this up on the website, because it's basically an alphabetized list correlated with the phone book in 1925. Now, we broke this story 20 years ago, and the U of O basically, one, refused to publish it, refused to acknowledge it in any way, until the 3 historians, when basically, you know, students who had basically co-taken this class at the U of O basically started agitating for changing Dunn's name and Dedi Hall and et cetera, in recent years. And then they basically commissioned 3 historians, one a former historian, who was at the U of O, who left for the University of Washington, a black man who is an expert on blacks in the Northwest. And I asked him, okay, so why didn't you do a Black History of Eugene? Because you're a professional historian. Sherry and I are amateur historians.
Did you say did it, or why didn't you?
Why didn't he? And he said there was no material here. And I said, no material? Like the Klan, like talking to the Reynolds family, like talking to Willie Mims, like talking to all these people that were here during that time, no material. So we're finding a lot of material. Why didn't you talk? I mean, you're black. Why didn't you talk to the black people?
Because you're
black. That's a reason not to talk to the black community?
Yeah.
Well, in any case, he didn't. We did. And part of, because there was such a impetus for not talking about the Klan, but it became central to our understanding of the Klan, because here's what happened. They said that the Klan died in 1925. And my experience and the black community's experience of Ku Klux Klans is they are not a fad. They're secret organizations. They do not, if they disappear, it's because they went underground.
Are they still around now?
Yeah. Because, I mean, you know, the tag in Stewart Pond in 2004, they've also morphed to other areas. Now, when we talk about Klansmen vibrations, okay, while the McDonald name doesn't appear on the membership list from the 1920s, he did allow Klan-friendly movies in his theater, i.e. the McDonald Theater, basically a theater of which, if it didn't have a peanut gallery or quote-unquote nigger heaven, i.e. the segregated upper seats in the balcony, basically followed the segregated policies of many businesses on Willamette Street, including Seymour's, which is now Actors Cabaret, J.J. Newberry's, which is now the Dax Children's Child Care, Woolworth's, which is now the Woolworth, it was a hole, now it's got sizzle pie.
So they're not those things now or had any affiliation to their past?
Right, yeah, right now. And they make no reference to their past. The theater was also basically featured in the forced relocation of Japanese citizens, but that wouldn't be till the 40s. So this High Lake Theater, which is now on the site of what is the Hult Center at the moment, in the 40s. The featured films was The Face in Your Window and The Ku Klux Klan Rides Again. Question, yeah.
Yeah, I bring these assertions up due to the fact that it seems like most of the information that we're retrieving is opinion-oriented and does not relegate some of the comparisons to things such as a witch hunt or, i.e., the damage that can happen to not actually repair racial discretion or transgression, but actually incites it. And I don't think that that is being reviewed in how this information is being relegated. There seems to also be the originators of the information seem to have had a hostile upbringing in the same environment that may have led to certain bias, and that is concerning as well.
Well, basically, when I'm talking about, you know, putting together a list that is basically one taken from unbiased sources, which I have to assume that the Los Angeles DA investigating a crime against police officers is going to basically raid a house and come up with the organizing lists of a secret organization that's going to be reported as fact because it's going to be considered as fact by historical sources. Now, if a newspaper, for example, is going to be the historical record for a community and it ceases to report news, so for example, when we get to the 1950s and, you know, when we talk about the black community and the experience of the black community, they experienced weekly cross burnings which were not reported to the newspaper. They experienced, you know, discrimination from the banks and the schools and housing, and that's why Mattie Reynolds became running for the Human Rights Commission because of the housing issue. So basically, when you talk about, you know, authoritative sources and then the reporting of the news, and then, for example, Eckhart Tolle, who, you know, basically got his degrees from the U of O reporting on the Klan, basically said, well, you can't really say that people burning crosses in the latter part of the 20th century are Klansmen because you don't have the authority to, you know, get the Klan lists. So, you know, when you ask the question about, do I have current lists? Well, they learned their lesson in 1920. Don't do, you know, lists where they can be found out and don't publish them. because people are not, you know, going to be sympathetic to them until this current administration. And even then, they're not going to necessarily do that.
That was my whole assertion, that not only would it force individuals to go back into hiding, so was that thought about before it was, before it was explored, being the makers of such actions, and also was the effect towards racial relations for the people that suffered unfairly to not be supportive there after being allies, as their names may have come up and they have had no affiliation there of understanding or even knowledge that this was either happening or had occurred. Not that the Klan occurred, but that their family played such a significant role in the process and the ability for individuals in a community to accept and relegate that information. I don't know if that time has come yet. I think that that process is still in action, and we as beholders of knowledge may want to be gentle and also thoughtful in how that knowledge is applied.
Well, I'm choosing to basically be a truth teller out loud in public, because I don't feel that basically historical evidence is historical evidence.
So say, take it how you will. I mean, if your grandfather was a Klansman, your grandfather was a Klansman.
Yeah.
That's the way it is.
You don't have to tell me.
Like, if you, so for me personally, I've never felt what a lot of people consider white guilt, but I may have considered a lot. Like, I may have, if I found out that my grandfather was a Klansman or his father was a Klansman, and my family has looked back and from what we know, it's been a very long time before or since my family has even anything close to owned a slave. But if I found out that my grandfather was a Klansman and his grandfather was a Klansman, there might be more I would do as far as advocacy goes to make up for that. If I found out that one of my family was doing stuff and burning crosses every week, I'd probably start, volunteering and, you would feel that guilt. You would feel like you had to make up for the fact that your family were not good people.
And there are many examples of that. Yeah. So, for example, we haven't gotten to World War II yet, but Henry Ford's picture was on Adolf Hitler's desk, not because he wrote a publication called The International Jew. It's because Ford Motor Company supplied Nazi Germany with tanks and jeeps and material. The Bush family, Herbert Walker Bush, George M. Bush, basically created Union Bank, which funded Hitler's brown shirts. Standard Oil gave them oil. IBM built the computers that allowed the Holocaust to happen. But Henry Ford's grandson converted to Judaism and bought a very expensive Quran. And I'm sure he was motivated by the racism and anti-Semitism of his grandfather. So it is up to succeeding generations to basically make good. So when we talk about the Toledo incident, let's move on before we got about half hour left. The Toledo incident in Oregon, basically, there was a book written about it where July 10th, 1925, the Pacific Spruce Company was the largest old-growth mill in the country, and Toledo, Oregon, brought 32 Asian workers to work green chain, a lumber sorting process. The Japanese weren't the biggest or strongest guys, but management knew they worked as a team. Scandinavians and others who pulled chain were often too proud to ask for help, and their work sometimes had to be sorted twice, according to the book written by a man who researched it. A newspaper article stated the owner felt white people were too lazy and slow to work green chain, which becomes pretty interesting, given the logging industry here, and also a statement that Republican former Senator Gordon Smith said about his vegetable freezing and packing organization. He said white people were too lazy. That's why he used Mexicans, because they had a good work ethic. They didn't get drunk. They basically worked and were diligent workers. And so we find this interesting trope where people are saying, okay, I'm employing these workers because they seem, you know, they're immigrants that are being allowed, for whatever the politics are around Oregon, they're being allowed to work here as opposed to Chinese workers, and I'm finding that they're productive. So for months, some town leaders had spoke out against rumors that the mill would hire minorities. They basically thought Asians would steal jobs. This sounds familiar. Undercut wages and lower property values.
Didn't they say that shit about every single immigrant?
Well, yeah. So when you think about these tropes, you know, it's like.
They say it about Asians because Asians were so wealthy and so productive in the communities, and they did, most of the Europeans in this area depended on them for their education. So it was a harder sale to say that the savage African American individual who was just strong. These individuals were not only organized, they were smart and depend on them.
So anyway, mill workers, mill managers ignored those sentiments from the community, thinking how they run their business was how they run their business and none of the business of the public. And so the mill got the local Chamber of Commerce to support its decision. So the Japanese arrived thinking local tensions had been resolved. But on Sunday, July 12th, a mob of more than 50 men, the stars and stripes up front, that is the American flag, marched to Tokyo Slough, which is where they were living. They were urged on by about 250 women and children. The chanting crowd overpowered armed, deputized mill workers, presumably white, but in any case, they threatened the Asians and demanded they leave. Now, this mob was also led by the sheriff.
I think that's why I mentioned the Snake River, because this was the end of that whole era in the nation where they were just basically going into communities of Asian people and annihilating them.
Well, it certainly wasn't the end of murder against communities of color, but. That not so in Oregon. They were actually wiping them out too. But that's taken up in Asian American studies, not here. So of the Asians, only the Japanese foreman, who initially said he wouldn't leave, was beaten. Thankfully, they didn't fight back, so it would have been a disaster if they'd put up resistance. So they were moved from Toledo, Oregon, by the coast, to Philomath. Toledo's police chief, whose wife was a main rabble-rouser, turned a blind eye to the clash, knowing that the mob was basically determined to use force to drive the Japanese out. So basically, that's Lincoln County, Toledo. And that's another, basically, just to give you an idea of some of the racial conditions in the early 20s. So moving on, and I'll put this up on the site.
Is this book, was it Little Yokohama that covers that whole area?
They definitely called the slough Little Tokyo Slough.
Is that in relation to Little Yokohama by any chance?
Maybe. I don't know. Never heard that. All right. So the Great Migration. Basically, black Southern people hoped to leave the color line in the South behind, where they moved north, but found that though the rules were unwritten, there were still rules, racial segregation rules, nonetheless. Sometimes violently enforced. So in Chicago, for example, during the Red Summer, a 5-day riot between whites and blacks basically sparked when a black teenager who basically had floated onto a white beach on Lake Michigan was attacked by a mob, and initially initiated by white street gangs fighting to secure their quote-unquote turf. So part of the Great Migration was not necessarily it was to escape terrorism in the South, but they often encountered there were actually several Great Migrations, but the main one that they're talking about basically in the 30s was to escape racial segregation in the South. Covered this. So progress. All right. Covered the birth of Negro History Week, but in 26, Carter Woodson started Negro History Week basically as the second week of February. It was expanded to a month after the Watts riots in 65. Kwanzaa would be invented in 1966 along with Kawaida theory. When Tody K. Barbara, basically the Depression is collaborating with the enemy, she was basically referring to the emotion which you should not necessarily indulge in, but rather forge your own freedom. The Great Depression is what everybody focused on in terms of the economic market crash and the conditions of the current market crash, because there was a recession just before Obama. But there's been several recessions, definitely. Which, as you've noticed, though the definition is based on a certain agreement upon fictions, that is economic fictions, not so much reality, people are being depressed, but other people are thriving in other ways. So while many focus on hard times, job loss, companies and banks failing, people continued living and learning. So remember that in these times of Trump, that maybe you could be depressed, but they're staying focused. He is often the way through, and basically maintaining a healthy culture is also a form of wealth. Financial, media, cultural, technological, and other types of literacy will also be key. So critical thinking and all using those particular strategies. So the strategies people used to survive were included rent parties, cooperative economics, pooling resources, and working to tide people through tough times. So when America catches cold, black people get pneumonia. So the dictum, last to be hired, first to be fired. You have to be twice as good to be considered equal. Unemployment rose to 25% of the labor force. Black unemployment was 50%. National income dropped from $81 billion in 1929 to $40 billion in 1932. 21 million Americans turned to public assistance. That's where basically welfare was invented. Rural Southern blacks, cotton drops from 18 cents per pound, and 100 pound sacks, basically, you know, would, if you do the math, or $432 a month or less, to less than 6 cents So from $18 a day to $6 a day, or $144 a month. So when you talk about a depression, where real wages drop, it's definitely tough times. Mechanization made many of these jobs gone to machines, gone to white people, or gone out of style. So we're seeing a repetition of when this college was created, basically being a training school for white men doing manual labor. When the labor gets replaced by machines, and the machines, the mechanical machines, get replaced by technology, and tech jobs become the rule, where are the people in Marcola left? Marcola is a rural area from here, 30 miles from here.
They do rural jobs. So when computers take over and computer jobs are all that are available, what happens to people who are picking? I guess farming is always going to be a thing.
Who don't have education?
Yeah, basically, when people don't have education enough to be able to change with the times, whatever those are, then they get left out of the loop.
They actually go back to starting with no innovation, and they create the greatest think tanks in the world.
Not in Marcola.
No.
My experience in basically the students that are coming here, okay?
But that's not a prejudice.
That's a fact.
Yeah.
That's not my experience.
Okay, my experience and the experience of students coming here is that they're basically having, to go from, one of the people I trained in Springfield to become a drug counselor was a third generation meth cook, ex-biker gang, okay? But they turned to cooking and dealing meth because their timber jobs got exported out of the country. They were a timber company, basically doing timber work, and their perception was they didn't need to even graduate high school because they would have a job in the woods,
yeah,
or pulling green chain or working for Weyerhaeuser. But when Weyerhaeuser sent their jobs elsewhere, they had no money, so many of them turned to growing weed or dealing meth. It was a very common thing during the 80s, 90s, early aughts. Okay, and that is a fact. Many of them came to Lane Community College, and he decided, dealing meth is not going to be the way for me, so maybe I should give back. How do I become a drug counselor? Okay, we'll take you from a fourth grade education, literally, to being part of the medical community, because here's the thing that we're dealing with training this workforce. Okay, you're going to have to be computer literate, mostly because, besides writing papers, but also keeping up with the fact that the medical community is going to go to computers. Now,
how does that give black people pneumonia?
Okay, it's a metaphor. So when America catches cold, black people get pneumonia. Okay? So the idea, back in the Depression, when people were worse off, black people got even more worse off because of systemic discrimination. The problem is that most of the communities like Marcola, like Springfield, like rural Oregon are largely white, and they're being left out of the technological boom if they're not going to school. And they didn't have a value for going to school. So other people who have a value for going to school and getting degrees and keeping up with the technology, we're basically seeing that kind of like a repeat of that. So
I don't think there's enough information out there for that.
There is. All right, so this caused the migration of blacks from the rural south to the urban north. And mechanization, basically Caucasianization of quote-unquote black jobs, So street cleaning in the urban areas, garbage collection, domestic work, discrimination, pay kickbacks to white foremen, to keep your factory job, which then basically goes to a white man who pays no kickback, was basically one of the things that they encountered when in moving to the North, the industrialized North. White women basically competed with black women for work as maids, cooks, housekeepers. So black women were often paid $5 a week to work in sort of slave market jobs, to wait on sidewalks for working class white women to pick you up on the corner. So for example, when you have, while you have organized institutions like Labor Ready, in many markets where you're basically hiring undocumented people, basically this was being done with citizens during the Depression, and basically you will still find that in places like LA as well as here, where you know you hire a Mexican or whatever to do the labor that Americans won't do.
Or they'll do for cheaper.
Or faster, or whatever.
But isn't that guy that's like selling meth in drains, isn't he literally a bio savant or a biochemist savant, but just not in the right echelons? Isn't that individual out there growing marijuana, a biochemist working with anatomy, with biology, with photosynthesis in a way, and vermicomposting and soil production in a way that could save our country? Isn't it really...
It's still illegal, and with a Trump administration, it could be made even more illegal. Despite
growing on a large, you can have 8 plants. If they catch you at the farm that's an acre wide, they're going to arrest you. They're going to burn all of your plants.
So we don't benefit from the things that are there to allow the individuals that are otherwise being obstructed or creating obstacles. So we don't allow for someone that's coming out of incarceration for sales of marijuana to get a license to be working at a dispensary and have a job doing it. We don't do that.
Nope.
Why don't we?
Because we're stupid.
Right. Okay. I'm not saying that it's not that what we do is right. I'm just posing the question so we can engage in some conversation about it, because I'm seeing the solution and not really always being so obstructive. And I'm concerned, especially in this subject matter, that some of the information eclipses the desire of it. And then there's little gaps and things are left out. So that's why I'm asking the question.
I do think there is a state, I don't remember exactly which one, but it's one of the legal states that is setting up programs for people who are incarcerated for marijuana charges to be able to open up marijuana businesses.
Which would be awesome.
But I'm not sure which state it is, I'll definitely
check that out.
Yeah. But there's only one of the 8 legal states that are currently doing that. So things definitely need to change.
I can imagine how different that is from like 5, 10 years ago.
I mean, there certainly are parallels I'm just trying to draw the idea from what was happening in the Great Depression that, again, if what goes around comes around, it's coming around again in a different form. But it's predictable, so how you can get out of it. So. In the South, for example, no job. You know, there was the idea of no jobs for niggers until every white man has a job. When is that going to happen? And when has that ever happened? Niggers back to the cotton fields. City jobs are for white folks. And then Southern Railroad, basically the brotherhoods, the unions. Basically initially attacked and murdered black workers to take their jobs. 12 black firemen were murdered for their jobs in various parts of the country in the North. So when basically people are basically leaving the South to for greater opportunity in the North, they're finding themselves racially tacked out of the frying pan, so to speak, into the fire. White employers maintain blacks only fit for dirty, unpleasant, low-paying, and heavy laboring jobs. We don't have a foundry in our plant, and that is the only work that Negroes are best suited for. And what does ghetto mean in Polish? Foundry, ghetto. So Milwaukee, we just sort of work like a family here. We bring in, if you bring in Negro workers, that would cause confusion and white workers to feel their jobs have been lost to indignity by being done by Negroes. So 24 union affiliated with the AFL, the American Federation of Labor, basically barred blacks entirely. So when we're talking about Depression era civil rights work and people are trying to escape the oppression of the South to go to the North, what they are finding is more oppression, more varied oppression. So it's kind of like, yes, America has catched cold. They're in the Depression. Black people are experiencing pneumonia, that is worse symptoms in an era where they had expected greater freedom. So Republicans did little for blacks, because Republicans, again, if you remember, were the party of Lincoln, and Lincoln freed the slaves, Democrats were a little better. Franklin Delano Roosevelt supported segregation during World War II. Democrats rejected the NAACP proposals, ACCP proposals for civil rights plank, basically calling for an end to racial discrimination and lynching. FDR felt that he needed the Southern segregationist vote to pass needed legislation for the country. But with the growing influence of the black vote, he began to shift with some needed pushes. So black people had traditionally voted Republican up until FDR, and then they switched to Democrat because FDR was a Democrat. I see you got a question.
Wasn't Martin Luther King a Republican?
No. Yeah, he was a Democrat.
He was?
Yeah. The shift happened with FDR. The black shift happened with FDR.
Why do you think that is?
Basically because the opposition was definitely, the Republicans
were more
were even more resistant. The Southern Democrats were basically resistant as well. They called themselves the Dixiecrats.
Isn't that like basically the same reason that the Dixiecrats switched to the Republicans? Is the same
yes.
Reason that
the Dixiecrats switched to the Republican Party, and the Democrats became aligned with FDR, and black people began switching to Republicans, basically, in terms of the policies that were enacted during the Depression.
So do you think people should switch back?
I think there is, we should, one...
Third party.
Yeah, well, there are a variety of solutions.
Democrats are just as racist as Republicans. They just hide it better.
Like with anything, it's not necessarily a matter of whatever the binary, the accepted binary is. It's like Obama was a Democrat, but you had conservatives that are Democrats. Republicans were the party of Lincoln, but they also became more segregationist.
The party of Ronald Reagan now.
5 minutes? Thank you. So February, so when I made the reference to the Star Wars analogy for American civil rights, in 1936, Gormo meets Yoda. That is, if Howard Thurman is Yoda, the teacher of Yoda is a being called Gormo. That is Gandhi. So February 20th, 1936, Reverend Howard Thurman, his wife Sue Bailey Thurman, and Reverend Edward G. Carroll meet for 3 hours with Mahatma Gandhi near Bardoli, India. It may be through the Negroes that the unadulterated message of nonviolence can be delivered to the world. Martin Luther King, of course, is seven, so he's not part of that, but his...
Gandhi said that?
Yeah.
I'm shocked.
Yeah, I know.
I'm shocked because he's a racist.
Well, he was a wife beater, definitely. I don't know about racist, but...
Have you not seen what he
really
said about the Africans?
That's really gone off the subject and really distract... I mean, I'm sorry, I apologize. I really want to get...
Yeah, we're talking about the...
The whole wife beating thing is just like, I don't get it. I just...
Yes, well... In any case, the personal failings of a leader are no indicators of the merits of his cause. So Du Bois tried to bring Gandhi to America for nonviolence. So Gandhi couldn't come to America, so many black leaders would go to Gandhi. And Thurman went to Gandhi because of the whole piece around how do you do nonviolence. And so Gandhi's statement was, perhaps the message of nonviolence can come through American blacks. So Thurman was Martin Luther King's teacher because Martin Luther King didn't really know how to do a nonviolent civil rights action. And because Bayard Rustin, who was a student of Thurman's, was at Montgomery in Martin's house when it got bombed, he said, okay, you got a shotgun, you got a pistol, you're waiting for the Klan to come back to firebomb your house. If you shoot the Klan, they will wipe you out because they have the guns and the law on their side. But if you use nonviolence, and by the way, maybe you should come visit Howard Thurman at Boston University, which is where Martin did his master's work and his doctorate. That's where the connection was. So Gormo meets Yoda. Okay? The idea that, all right, we're trying to engage Gandhi no matter what his personal failings are, you know, because he was considered black by America. That's why he couldn't come to America. They wouldn't give him a visa. They wouldn't give him a hotel. So black people said, okay, we can't come. Gandhi can't come to us. We'll go to Gandhi because he was basically dealing with South Africa and then India, which was a British colony. And how do you liberate, you know, yourself from racism? So, let's see. Meanwhile, as Lord Martin Luther King says, poverty is violence. Then one of poverty's relatives is ignorance. So begin to educate yourself. Yes?
And I'm glad that you ended on that because I feel like I saw that in Martin Luther King, Dr. Reverend Martin Luther King Jr.'s face when he met Stokely. And he was immersed in this epic center in the South, the South, where there was so much balancing towards taking action, and that action was violence and this in the shape of defending oneself. And I really got this feeling that Dr. Reverend Martin Luther King had to seriously go inside of himself, seemingly almost back to this moment of where Gandhi is coming to Thurman and explaining this idea where it's developing in this chaotic time of how are you going to get what you want when someone's coming at you with a knife and a gun and a sword. And here I saw Martin Luther King in the midst of the results of the knife, the sword, and the gun, and the blood dripping still. And I really felt like he took a lot of pause and a lot of momentum to get back to this founding center of, I can really understand what you want, and I really understand why. And I feel like he shaped a really powerful message that still exemplified peace, as this explains. So thank you for sharing.
But there would be a long way to go before we get there. So let's leave it here, and I will post this in an hour or two, and we'll see you Monday.
See you in a